I've read somewhere from the Bible when Jesus addresses the Father. For example, at the cross, when he prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they know what they do. My Father in heaven will be with you, and going to my Father, if we're not." My Father is another that Jesus often made. Whenever he especially was talking to the disciples, he always made a picture of him and the Father. I remember some time back you taught that there's only and only one God. There's nothing like Son, Spirit, Father, blah, blah. How do we compare that and explain that?
Okay. Language of God and let me start with Ilya's question. How many of you believe that there's one God? There's only one God. Okay. And that God is Jesus Christ. Okay, that God is His glory altogether. And how many of you know that God does not understand the same things as we do? His understanding capacity is far away from that of ours. How many of you believe that? Okay. And I also belong to a group which believes that God is in trouble of communicating to people who do not understand their language. Let me give you a demonstration. Cassiwat is a medical doctor. Okay. There are things he wants to explain to his daughter. What's her name again?
Angel.
There are things he wants to explain to Angel in medicine. Okay. How does Kasimante go? And in which language does Kasimante speak to Angel so that Angel understands a concept in medicine in the most professional language? Do you think you can go ahead and bomber Angel with all the terms and the technical terms in medicine? No, I think that's not wise, isn't it? Okay, why? But again, Kasibant has an obligation, or he has a duty to tell or to deliver the same message to Angel. But that message is encrypted. Is that the word? It's encrypted in medical language. But Kasibant has a duty to tell Angel and make sure Angel understands. Okay? Make sure Angel understands. So how does Kasimante do that? Okay? He does it the kindergarten way, isn't it? He does it the kindergarten way. You break down each and everything, turn all those terms into dolls and playthings, make them funny, use languages, language which is not allowed technically speaking, go down and so forth, so that you make sure you communicate to Angel. Have you seen teachers of kindergarten? They are stupid, eh? They behave stupidly. They dance, sit down with them, jump like they jump, go emotional, da 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 da. Just trying to make these kids do what? Understand the concept of God, isn't it? Sometimes when they are teaching, the kids are, they took away. And then the teacher sits down and says, don't decide it's not a koi, isn't it? But because the audience is a koi, see? So the teacher is always trying to speak the language of these kids. Now, why am I telling you all this? I am teaching you a very technical term in theology, which is called anthropomorphism. You don't have to pronounce it. Okay? Anthro what? Homophysic. So it's you don't know, but you see, I've simplified it. Eh? What I've been telling you is what in theology we call what? Anthropomorphism. Now, what is anthropomorphism? Anthropomorphism is when God speaks and behaves in the way of people. Okay? Yes, the way God communicates to people to make sure that you understand. Yeah? Okay? The Uganda Bible says, Israel totia gwenamwandu kubanga nze balo. But we all know God does not marry. Isn't it? God does not do what?
He does not marry, neither does he do those things that we do, you guys. But he promises the widow that I am your what? I am your husband. Don't you dare fear, for I am your husband. That's a very anthropomorphic statement, encouraging the widow that I will be there. I will fill the gap that a man ought to have filled if he was there. He's trying to speak. I am your husband. Husband. God is a husband. I am your father. I am your lion. The Jews used to call God the Lion of Judah. Okay, the Lion of Judah, because the language is very symbolic. Lion is the king of the jungle and one of the strongest animals, if not the strongest anyway. So they have to attribute all those good attributes to God, anthropomorphism. Now, when God comes here, he's in trouble. He needs to save people who are not comfortable with him coming in his original nature. Okay, I'm trying not to spoil. If God came for who he is, we wouldn't appreciate, neither would we come even closer to him. I'll give you a demonstration. It is in the Bible. One day, the Israelites made some noise. They wanted to see this God who had led them out of Egypt and so forth. So they wanted to see him. Where are you? Where are you? We need to see you. So Moses went to God, told him, you know what? These guys want to see you. You should come and save me. Then God told them, all right, tell them to prepare, I'm coming this day. So tell them to cleanse themselves and so forth. I'm coming. All right. So the time came when he was doing what? When he was to come. He came. But before he reached his glory, okay, his glory came first. Okay, I think we need to teach what the glory of God is. If you want to understand what the glory of God is, take some time one of these days, if you get a chance, to see the sun in the sky and look into the sun for 5 seconds or 5 minutes. Directly like that. That's what we mean by the glory of God. That's how God looks. Okay. So before he came, that thing that is brighter than the sun came. But God had not come. He was just coming. So actually what came was his shadow. Now to help you kindergarten guys to understand. His shadow did what? Came. And it was brighter than the what? The sun. Then the Israelites started yelling, what? Tell him to go back. We don't want. We have seen. That is enough. Tell him to stop coming. So he did come. Now that very God who looks like that had to save man. Okay? He had to do what? To save man, and the only way to save man is to die, and you cannot die without a body. Okay? Now you've got to put on a body. So you put on that body, the flesh. That concept is called the theology of the incarnation. For God became man, John chapter 1, verse 14. For the word became flesh and dwelt among us. Philippians chapter 2, I think from verse 1 to, I think verse 5 to 8 says that he took on humanity. So God became flesh and dwelt among us. Now, the moment God became flesh, okay, it's very, very important, by the way, to understand that I'm one of the preachers who think, or actually believe, and can confirm that from Scripture, that when God was on planet Earth, he was here. When God was on planet Earth, he was here. Okay. That guy who walked on streets was God, and that was the entire God. Amen? So it is wrong to start believing that some part of God was left in heaven, and there's another part walking on the street. No, 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 no. That was the entire God. He was 100% divine, and 100% human incarnation. Why? Because he wanted to communicate and to approach me and you. Okay? Glory. Now that God, okay, has to communicate to the kindergarten school we. Okay? Who cannot believe, like you can't believe, that Katonda ali awedeyo yali awo? Amen? Who cannot believe that is the entire God? The one who shook the mountains, the one who created this entire universe was the guy walking in one gown. And that guy who was hungry, who could get tired, was the one who created the entire universe. Okay? So this guy has to communicate to this school, the we. Let them understand. Simple, what my professor calls cheap things. He has to communicate to this kindergarten that I am God, okay, but to speak your language, I have a father in heaven. Now listen to his language, my ego. I have a father in heaven, and that father and me are one. Whoever has seen me has seen the father. No, show us the father. No, you don't need to see the father if you have seen me. For I am the father, and the father is me. Then why waste call him father? Because that's the only way you can understand. You are so fixed in father, children. But I am the father, and I am the son. Okay?
Could I have caught it well?
Mm-hmm.
That one of the main reasons Jesus always addressed the father was to answer a common question of, we see you have a mother. How come you have not a father?
Okay.
Was he always trying to address that?
Okay.
Trying to complete his part of humanity.
Yeah, sure. You bring an environmental question, the environment of Jesus and what he went through. A lot of people did not believe his theology of the Yahweh is my father and me and the father are one, because they knew that he was coming from Nazareth and was bastard by this lady who claimed that she became pregnant but still a virgin. I mean, scientifically not possible. Okay, and then of course people looked at Joseph with a very skeptical eye. Maybe you guys did these things and you're denying and so forth. So Jesus, by the way, Jesus never went defensive to answer your question. He never went defensive about that. There's one day they looked for him and told him, your mother and father are looking for you. And he said, no, I don't have a mother, I don't have a father. My father and my relatives are those who do the will of God. I think he never did, though he respected them, I think, on that note. Spent 30 years with them under their custody. He did ministry for 3.5 years and he passed on. He was a very good son. Please be good children to your parents, like Jesus was. I always like to pick those lessons. Those are very interesting. So Jesus always addressing the father thing. He's trying to communicate to us difficult things in a simplistic language. Okay? If you want to understand this thing of the Trinity, you just need to read John chapter 14, verse 8. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and we shall be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you so long, and yet you do not know me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? Okay? That's one person, right? I am in the Father and the Father is in what? Is me. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I said to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his work. Believe me that I am the Father. Okay? The Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. So Jesus was the Father, but the love that you see in the Bible is for you and me who cannot understand difficult things in their technical language. So there's one God. Okay, I wish I had time to go into the polytheism and monotheism thing, worshipping one God and worshipping many gods and the dangers of those things. They are dangers. They are dangers. They are dangers of
The dangers, eh?
The danger of believing.
Yes, there are dangers of believing in a God who is more than one. The three gods get ranks. Okay, they get ranks. Bobokiriza mu bakatonda basatu bafuna chepe. Kati bafuna chepe, buli chepe ekola ku bizibu ebiri specific. Okay, chepe is rank. Rank. And once they get, once your gods are ranked, then those guys with specific rank address specific problems. So when you have an issue of forgiveness, you don't go to the Father. Okay? You go to the Son. Alright?
Mm.
You see? Now when you have issues of you need to feel it, get vibrated and so forth, you don't go to the Son.
You go to the Holy Spirit.
You go to the Holy Spirit and then be in the Spirit and move your body. Shake. Go into meditation and be taken and see visions and dreams. That is the Holy Spirit. I was in the Spirit. That God Spirit takes you into tongues. You start speaking tongues which you cannot even translate. Because there is that God who deals with that department. Then the Father, of course, is the judge who is willing to kill you unless you are saved by the what?
The Son.
Okay? Now, eventually, the ranks drop. They go now from the Trinity to representative people who have connections and relations with that Trinity. Are you following what I'm saying? They drop now. Now they go. Now, it is not easy to approach the Son. If you want to approach the Son, where some people go through the Mother, Mama Otusabire, then Mama Otusabire Omwana, kati no mwana na ya Otusabire wani? Ewa tata. You see? That's the problem now of the Trinity. That's the problem. Then, there's also another problem. I'm sorry I'm not attacking, but I'm trying to educate you. There's also another problem whereby the Father in the Trinity, the Father is a very bad man. Very bad, very bad. Actually, his aim and goal is to kill all of us. What is stopping him is this stubborn boy of his, Jesus. So that is why Jesus is in heaven, heavenly sanctuary, pleading with this furious Father who wants to kill us. Dear God, it is now Peter. He has changed these things. Okay, the other time he messed up, but now he has corrected. Okay. Put his name there. 30 minutes. You saw as good as that? Remove his name. So that's the God of the Trinity. Okay, that's the Trinity God. So this Jesus is always there pleading. You mess up, they erase your name. You get fit, they put back your name. Okay?
And always the Father with his palms.
And always the Son is here. You don't let me die for nothing. Look at my palms. And the Father says, okay, let me see what Peter does next. Or sometimes he says, I will think about it. And then Jesus says, think about it quick, Father. Okay, so those are the dangers of the Trinity. Then, lastly, but not least, if you believe in the Trinity, then you can worship each and every other thing that can serve the very purpose. Okay? Yes. Actually, Trinity is not Christian. Trinity is heathen. Yes. Bukafiri wenyini. Trinity is equal to...
Jaja Mukasa.
But let me first give you the biblical Jaja Mukasa also. And here. You see, one of the reasons as to why I have a problem is because I use this book. Okay, now. Chapter 17. So Paul, standing in the middle of Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious." Okay, very what? Very religious. Trinity is for religion, not for Christianity. Religion is heaven. Acts 17, verse 22. Very what?
Religious.
Very religious. Now see what religions do. For us, I pass along and observe the objects of your worship. Now, religions are objects of worship. Okay? I found also an altar with this inscription to an unknown God. So religions have a lot of altars. And one of them is the unknown God. They worship everything until they come to the extent of not knowing what they are worshiping, and then they also name that. This one we are worshiping, but we don't know. Okay? So the simple thing, like the Bire and Serubi, the Ancient Fathers, Yagya Mukasa. What is Mukasa? For what is Mukasa? Wankuba. Wankuba. Mukasa. Musoke, you are Mukuba. Can you get another Samile? So, do you want me? Do you want a hunter? I want to ask you. Why want to buy? You win Yang. What you come? So, that's the problem of Trinity, this guy. Okay. Yes, Uganda.
Yes, Pastor, I have a question.
Yes.
Following what you are trying to say.
Okay.
We have plural and singular.
Okay.
In Genesis, God says, let us.
Yes.
Let us.
Yes.
I want you to clarify on that.
Okay. Good. Now, that is verse 26. And then God said, let us make in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over the cattle of the earth. I wish I had time. But I want you to go back and try and access the Hebrew Bible and press the word us, the plurality there. Press the plurality there of us. You notice that in the Hebrew setting, this word of us is an English mistranslation. How do I know? If there is anything that Jews have given or passed on to us, it is only one doctrine of here, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. This is why Jews had problems in the New Testament with Jesus Christ, because if they had believed that there is any us, of three gods, or of a god more than one, they would have taken Jesus by his word. But because the Old Testament is very consistent with one God, Yahweh, you will find this us thing only in Genesis 1:26. Has anyone read the book of Genesis, or the Old Testament? I want to discuss with those who have read the Old Testament. Some, by the way, I told you to read the Bible, the entire Bible. Read it like a novel. Read it and finish it, and read it again. Just read it. You don't need to. Don't need to understand. Just go through. Shh. Okay. And I told you the benefit of that. After you've gone through, when people start speaking about what you've gone through, it clicks. That's how your brain works. So just go through. This let us make is only in Genesis 1:26 in the entire Old Testament. There is no Trinity in the Old Testament. The gospel of the Old Testament is here, O Israel, the Lord your God is what?
Is one.
Is one. The only worship. So this let us think of Genesis 26 is a Hebrew translation problem. And if you come back again here, I will take you through Hebrew when I have time for this specific word. Blessing. Okay, so Israel was a monotheistic religion. Actually, it is the only thing that it passed on to Christianity. Only one thing. So the Christians, imateka ibisigade bigine bizibu
nyaderu kubuza nesina ina yali ko
jibibie bibi nanga bigine bizibu bino bino sinaya ali sinaya satan inarusha sinaya is prosperity. You read my book, Prosperity. Actually, Jesus saved us from four forces, and one of them is the law.
Yeah.
You have to make sure that you are saved from the law, my dear sister and brother, if you are to be saved. If you are still clinging to the law, or with me, see you. See you, eh?